for people that don't really understand this stuff, what is there something unique about the ideology of Islam that is creating this level of repression right now, or this level of violence? Like, do you think it is unique amongst, let's say, the three monotheistic religions? Mm-hmm. Or you can take any religion if you want.
I don't know if it's unique, but I think that it's definitely the most powerful right now. Like, there are a lot of Islamic theocracies currently. There are no Christian theocracies. And these Islamic theocracies currently are very powerful. They're very rich, mm-hmm. Monarchies. So they wield a lot of political power. Everybody knows that Saudi Arabia is a horrible place, yeah. Right? The story of Dina just the other day, like disappearing when she was trying to escape from Saudi Arabia. And then they got the Philippines to send her back home again. And now who knows what's going to happen to her.
Yeah.
Nobody likes Saudi Arabia. Everybody says, oh, we should stop, being allies with them. But what are we? We're allies with them. Canada just, made a deal with them for billions of dollars for selling armored trucks. And it's not just Canada, it's also America, it's also UK. Like, we're all making deals with Saudi Arabia, even though we know that they're a horrible country. So
basically we're making deals really related to oil, while at the same time they're exporting all of this Wahhabism. They're building mosques in Germany. I think, what is there?
Canada,
there's something like 600% more mosques in the last 2 years or something mm-hmm, crazy like mm-hmm. that.
Yeah. The school that I went to was funded by Saudi Arabians. So initially when I went there, it was a small mosque and our imam was from India. He's the leader of the community. And then they wanted to build a school there. So they took the money from Saudi Arabia and they built a school. And then our Indian imam got booted out and replaced with an Egyptian imam, and his wife came wearing the niqab. And it was all like everything changed. The whole community just became more conservative. And this is like in the 80s. So this has been happening for a very long time. We've been watching it happen. People within the community, a lot of Muslims for a long time have been screaming bloody murder, but it's just happening. Because it was only happening in our communities and it wasn't spilling out, mm-hmm. it didn't get the attention that it needed. But now that it's spilling out and nobody can deny it anymore, because we were told that, like I was told, and I know lots of other people were told as well, like, oh, you're just jaded. You know what I mean?
You're just jaded. Yeah,
you're
as a five-year-old.
Yeah. Yeah. You're not being fair to Muslims. You're just, you see things from your perspective, and it was a very, you had a negative experience and blah, blah, blah. So they weren't really...
I mean, there's so much richness in all of that. Yeah.
So you're not an authentic voice kind of thing. And so they would shut me down, just like they would shut everybody else down, right? This is something I'm sure you're familiar with. Like when Sam Harris is talking about Islam, they're, oh, it's this white American guy, have anything. Well, what he's saying is the truth, but that doesn't matter. It's just shut them down, right? Mm-hmm. So
how do we deal with some of that then? So, because I've talked about it many times, that night on Real Time, mm-hmm. that was my wake up about what was happening on the left. Like mm-hmm. I had these feelings mm-hmm. for a while mm-hmm. and it became so obvious that mm-hmm. night. I didn't know who Sam was. Here's mm-hmm. this guy laying out Pew statistics,
yeah.
gross and racist, yeah. all hell breaks loose, left attacks him. Now yeah. Bill Maher suddenly a racist, even though he had always stood for every liberal principle mm-hmm. ever. So you're dealing with it in two ways. So there's the Muslim community that's sort of hiding this stuff, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, then you have these sort of, you've got the sarsours of the world maybe mm-hmm. that are intentionally mm-hmm. doing it, but then you also have the well-meaning lefty. Mm-hmm. How do mm-hmm. we get that person? Because that's the person that I think we can move a little bit, right?
Yeah.
We're not gonna get sarsour to come around and be like,
no.
You know what, I've been doing some horrible stuff.
No.
Okay, yeah. Fine. But the well-meaning person, mm-hmm. how do you get them without, because I know what they, I see what they'll say about you and mm-hmm. what they'll say about a lot of these people. Mm-hmm. How do you get them?
Well, like you, that was a defining moment for me. That's what made me start to speak up. And it's because everything that Sam Harris was saying was spot on. And I was like, how does he know?
Like, he's a little pale for that.
Yeah. Like he's got it. Like those concentric circles yeah. and everything. I had no idea who he was either. And then of course my Facebook was all about like everybody supporting Batman and the thinking that he's so great and like yay rah rah that he was shutting down this gross and racist guy, and that's kind of what made me feel like, no, you've got it all wrong. Like I felt like I had to speak up because I'm a brown woman, an ex-Muslim, Arab background. You can't shut me down as quickly as you can shut down Sam Harris. Like Batman wouldn't be able to call me gross and racist. You know
right.
what I mean?
Right.
And so I felt like, I'm just gonna say the exact same thing he's saying, but it's just coming from a different, you know, it's the identity politics,
right? You're
right?
gonna use it against them,
yeah,
basically.
Yeah, yeah. And so now what? Yeah. You know what I mean?
Were you shocked at the response?
Yeah, so in the
How
beginning-
How quickly, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I was kind of expecting it, but I was also really shocked. I still am shocked.
Yeah.
I still am, like I'm more used to it now, but it's not like I have patience for it. You know what I mean? There's the bigotry of low expectations, like you mentioned, like that's something that really gets me emotionally riled up. Like I get so upset when people say things like, you know, like we know that, you know, all of that happens in the Arab world or in the Muslim world, and that's fine, but just keep it over there. I'm like, oh, really? Like their lives don't matter. Like it's okay if it happens over, as long as it doesn't spill into your soil, you're okay with it. You know, that's when you draw the line and you say, no, we can't have FGM or you know, any of that stuff happening here. But it's okay if it happens over there. You know, so that really upsets me because my whole reason for doing any of this is to support the women that were in the situation that I was in.
Yeah.
So when you look at like hashtag stop enslaving Saudi women or the hashtag my stealthy freedom, which are women from Iran that are just taking pictures of themselves without a hijab on.
Yeah.
That's it. But that could get them fined or imprisoned or even killed. So these are the women I'm speaking out for, like, because that was me. That was me hidden behind a veil and unable, I didn't have a support system. I didn't have anybody to speak to. I mean, now that we have social media, thankfully, we can connect with each other. And I think that's why Maryam Namazi coined it the tsunami of ex-Muslims. We were always around, but we're very quiet. I mean, I left Islam 15 years ago, but I wasn't going to say that to anybody.
Right. You know? And even within that, there's always the infighting with that kind of thing, because Maryam's had some fights with some people on this side of things, and it's always conflating and confusing. But how do you separate the religious part from the political part? Because I suspect that most people, if you were just to poll most Americans, don't care what anyone believes privately. Mm-hmm. And even if that means you're gonna subjugate your own child in a way, you know what I mean? Like for any religion, for the Mormons that are having them do this or Orthodox Jews that are having children wear this, or anything like that, I think most people would say, as long as you're not harming anyone out, go ahead. But there is a different element here because there's a political element here, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, oh, absolutely. Islam is political. That's its whole aim is to, so before when I was talking about the different cultures and the different kinds of Muslims from all across the Muslim world, all of their cultures have been, so let's take Egypt, for example, where my family is from. Everybody's familiar with Egyptian civilization, right? Like that's who Egyptians were before we were colonized by Muslims, and now we speak Arabic, and now Egyptians call themselves Arabs, you know, even though they're in North Africa. Like they've sort of internalized their masters, you know, and they're killing for them too, because now they're killing the Christians that are fellow Egyptians because they feel like, okay, now you're not one of us anymore.
Because basically
right?
you're not an Arab Muslim, basically. So there's pretty much no Christian. I mean, this is it, especially after these last attacks. I mean, there's virtually no Christians left in Egypt.
Yeah, and there was like one Jewish person left.
I think I met the one Jew there. Yeah. I'm not kidding. There was one Jew. Yeah. They were like, go down that street. There was one guy who's wearing a blue sweater.
And this is Egypt that's supposed to be like the progressive country, right?
Right.
Like when people talk about harsh Muslim countries, they don't usually say Egypt. They'll usually say like Pakistan or Saudi Arabia or Iran or whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, this is like supposedly one of the more progressive ones.
Yeah.
So again, these words don't work. Progressive, conservative, none of these don't define what it is that we're talking about because they don't fit that world.
So then what is the political goal? Because it's like, this is the part of the conversation that gets everyone crazy. Because if you listen to more right-wing people, they'll tell you that Islam is, it's coming, it's coming, it's trying to take over all of our societies, all that. Mm-hmm. I think there's an alarmist element of that, but I mm-hmm. think that there is also a piece of truth in that. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I don't want bigotry to happen against the nominal Muslim person that doesn't mm-hmm. that just wants the same freedoms that we all have. Mm-hmm. So how do you play between that, between the religious part and the political part?
So that question reminds me of Sam Harris actually asked that to Ayan in his podcast. He said, what's the line between the right-wing hysteria and the left-wing, you know, lies and obfuscation, basically? And she gave the best answer. She said, facts.
Right. Know? So then go back to those numbers and
at the research, look at the facts, look what people are telling you. You know, there's an imam in Australia that's like, I don't know if you heard about him, but he's like, you guys need to listen. You need to stop with the Islamic schools. You need to stop with the funding all of these mosques. You need to, you know, they're trying to take over. The people are speaking from within the community.
Yeah.
In Canada, we had a motion, M103, which was deemed, like, coined the Islamophobia motion. And, you know, obviously we have problems with the word Islamophobia because you're talking about fear of a religion as opposed to anti-Muslim bigotry. Mm-hmm. Muslims were fighting against that just as much as non-Muslim Canadians.
Yeah.
Because they left Pakistan or Iran or wherever where blasphemy laws are. I mean, look what's happened in Bangladesh with the bloggers. Raif Bedawi, not even a non-Muslim, but just blogging liberal things. And that'll get you in prison and that'll get you lashed. When people come to Canada or when they come to the United States, they don't want that garbage to follow them here. We don't mm-hmm. want blasphemy laws in our free country. You know, like, so Muslims are fighting against this, but just like ex-Muslims, our voices aren't being heard because it's not nice.
Yeah.
Instead, they will elevate the voices of people like Linda Sarsour, who will just say, you know, I am empowered by the hijab. Then they'll put the hijab all over, like, Vogue and Elle and a Nike swoosh on it and blah, blah, all this.
Which they would never do with any other religion, which in my view shows that they're the bigots.
Absolutely.
They're the actual bigots.
Yes.
Because they are looking at this group like they're this, if we can only elevate them to the point that they'll feel good, then we can feel good about themselves.
Yes.
It's narcissistic.
It's narcissistic.
It's gross
and
racist.
Arrogant. Yeah. And it's literally judging somebody based on the skin color as opposed to the content of their character.
Yeah. So one of the interesting, I think, sort of schisms in this community that you're a part of is that there are people, so there's someone like Majid who I don't know how he privately practices his faith, mm-hmm. but he identifies he's still Muslim and he's trying to reform his faith. Mm-hmm. And I know some people think that's the way to do it and some mm-hmm. people say, no, that'll never happen. And then there's someone like you and Faisal and Sarah that consider themselves ex-Muslims. Mm-hmm. What does that mean to you that you had to make such a definitive statement to say, I am not part of this anymore, as opposed to somebody, 90% of Jews that you would meet in America, they're not religious in any way, but nobody says I'm an ex-Jew. And mm-hmm. if you did say you were an ex-Jew, people would be like, well, mm-hmm. good for you.
Yeah.
So like, what is that there?
So I was just an atheist forever, like for 12, 13 years. And then when this whole Sam Harris, Bill Maher thing happened, that's when I discovered the term ex-Muslim. I didn't even know that it was a thing.
Yeah.
But I only started to use it when I started writing my book and having the Twitter handle and all that stuff, just to define myself as somebody who used to be Muslim. Mm-hmm. So that when I speak about Islam, people understand that it's coming from a personal experience. Really, that's all it means.
Yeah.
But I'm essentially, like, I'm a humanist, I'm an atheist, that's who I am.
But do you believe, without getting into the specifics of what Majid's doing, but for the people that are trying to reform it from mm-hmm. the inside, do you believe that's just an unwinnable game or an unattainable mm-hmm. goal or something like
that? Well, as an atheist, that would never be my goal, right? My goal is truth and honesty and what do we have evidence for, and that's what we're going to, you know, we'll just keep following the truth wherever it leads us, you mm-hmm. know, keep following the evidence. So I would never call myself a reformer. I would never advocate for like a kinder, gentler Islam. Like, mm-hmm. no, like, why would we want to advocate for somebody who's like a quasi flat earther or, or, you know, sort of an anti-vaxxer, but not totally. No.
Right. Like, I mean, I can see an argument for that in that it would just be if you can do any good, sort of.
Yeah.
But I get it. It's not your end game here. But no. I can see why someone else maybe would go down that route.
Yeah. I think that I am allied with people like Asr Nomani and Majid Nawaz and all the reformers because we share common goals in that we all believe in secular values, we all believe in liberalism, we all believe in LGBT rights, we all believe in women's rights. We have all of these shared values. So yeah, we'll work together towards those goals, but we're just going to work towards it in two different ways.
Right. And by the way, that's the point of a pluralistic society. Mm-hmm. Asr is allowed to believe what she wants mm-hmm. privately, and mm-hmm. you are too, and mm-hmm. hopefully you can make societies more liberal.
Yeah.
But where does that put you politically? Because all of the people we've mentioned here, mm-hmm. they simply are hated by the mainstream left. Mm-hmm. Everyone that we've mentioned, Asr, mm-hmm. the things that I see people write about her, it's all from the left, mm-hmm. nothing from the right. Mm-hmm. Majid, Southern Poverty Law Center, Ayan, mm-hmm. the people that hate Sarah, the people that hate Faisal, mm-hmm. mm-hmm. probably the people, Ali I don't see gets that much hate, but I'm sure he does, yeah. but the people that hate him. I mean, all of you guys, mm-hmm. I would say probably 90% from the left. Mm-hmm. Am I exaggerating?
No, you're not exaggerating.
So then
no.
Where does that put you guys?
Yeah, it puts us in a, you know, it's kind of, like I was mentioning before, like we're I want to say we're in the middle, but we're not really, like, it's not like we're in the middle, but we're kind of in that area in between where I think a lot of people are, because we, these days, if you don't fully align with everything that the people on the left want you to align with, you must be a far right bigot, mm-hmm. fascist, Nazi, blah, 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 right?
Yeah.
Like they don't see that middle ground.
I know the feeling.
Yeah. yeah, yeah. So I think all of us, you included, are all in that middle ground. But you're right, like somebody like Ayan, who has been fighting this fight for over a decade, she's not getting any support from her fellow liberals. She's getting support from conservatives. And then people say, oh, she's just a right-wing conservative. Well, she's trying to do good in the world. She's trying to get her message out. And however she can get her message out, that's her goal, right? And so if it's only Fox News that's going to invite her on, then she's going to go on Fox News mm-hmm. because she needs to get her message out. But then people just like dismiss her and they say, oh, she went on Fox News, therefore I don't want to hear what she has to say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so funny how you're right that we're all in it in our own different ways. Obviously, I come from a very different place than Ayan. But I even get that because mm-hmm. I've done some stuff on Fox News. And mm-hmm. people say, you see, he's going on Fox News. Mm-hmm. Guys, MSNBC can call me.
Mm-hmm.
I can't just show up at the office.
Yeah.
Guys, I'm here.
You know,
let's
do
it, Rachel.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
It's just not how it works. You know,
that's
not how it's going to work.
Yeah.
So do you find then, because we're agreeing on that basic theme there, that there is some room to move with people on the right? Because mm-hmm. I've seen that, and I've been able to have people sit here like Dennis Prager and Ben Shapiro mm-hmm. and Glenn Beck mm-hmm. and a few other people that I know I disagree with on politically on many levels, mm-hmm. but I've seen some bridge building there. Mm-hmm. Yes, some of them come from a religious. Prager mm-hmm. argues from a Judeo-Christian mm-hmm. thing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, it's not my thing, but mm-hmm. but that we basically can get to something.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find that? Are some of those types mm-hmm. of people reaching out to you? Like, is that where you see mm-hmm. that you can build some bridges?
So it's exactly when you were talking about Prager and when I was talking about Majid, it's the same kind of thing. Like I don't believe in Majid's religion and I don't believe in Prager's religion, but if we have common values, we have common goals, then we'll work together towards those common goals. So it's not even about the whole right-left spectrum or what news media they're from or all of that stuff, but it's about what is this person saying and do I agree with what they're saying and do I want to be aligned with them or do I want this person as my ally or do I want to be an ally to this person? So I would look at the values. I would look at the common values, which is what I'm hoping that more people will start to do.
Yeah.
Because we not only do we have the identity politics with skin color, but we also have identity politics with a political spectrum as well, with political sides. So people will be like, okay, so that's a right-wing person, so you can't talk to them. And I'm like, no, I'm going to talk to them. I want to know, like, what are you talking about? Let's hear it. Let's have a back and forth. Let's have a discussion. Same thing with somebody on the left. People on the left are usually much more aggressive. Like, you know, they will attack me. And I've had some people on the right attack me, but it's you know, they'll be like, yeah, you're a closet Islamist, or you know,
if you're a closet Islamist, you're doing an incredibly good job. You know, like, I haven't gotten one odd verbal cue or anything, body
it's
language.
I was against
whoever
them.
Taught you.
Yeah.
Like, A plus.
I'm doing well. The Muslim ban, the whole Donald Trump Muslim ban.
Yeah.
So I was like, well, this is ridiculous. It's not doing anything. You've got like 9 countries out of like over 50 countries. And like, it just, I thought the whole ban was very oddly and not thought out.
Mm-hmm.
So how could I, right? That means you want
to
overrun this country with Islamists, and therefore you're a closet jihadi and blah, blah, blah. So whenever I say anything against Trump, then that's when I get attacked from the right.
Yeah.
So, but I don't care. You know what? I was married to a jihadi. My mom.
Well, you've done it.
I've been through this, you know, like, my mom threatened to kill me. Like, bring it with your little 140 characters. Like, you think you're gonna, it's not gonna bother me.
Yeah.
Cause I've committed to doing this, and I'm gonna do this, and I don't care about the hate that's gonna come at me from whatever angle. I'm going to stay on point, and I'm gonna continue to say what I need to say. And I look at Ayaan Hirsi Ali, somebody like her who continues after her friend was murdered and after she was, you know, a bounty on her head basically, and she's still talking. And like, she was talking when she was in her interview with you, when she was talking about the difference between just existing and actually living. And I get that. And that's, you know, I can't stay quiet. I'm lucky that I'm here and that I can speak up. There are millions and millions and millions of people that literally cannot speak up because they will be killed for it.
Is that the craziest part here? That the fear factor, the chill factor, is that people think that if people like you speak up and then they defend you, that then they'll be marked too. Mm-hmm. But then all that does is amplify more fear. So literally, by you just sitting here and just telling me your life story, you've sort of whacked the ice, you know what I mean? You've put a crack in that, and that's what we just need more and more and more of.
Yeah, I say that in talks that I go to. Like, I implore people, please just talk about it honestly, you know? Be an unapologetic ally to the truth and to liberal values. Be proud of our liberal values. Be proud of where we've progress to. Be you know, honor the people that have died for us to have these freedoms now. Like, don't be, you know, like Ayaan Hirsi Ali said to that one Canadian guy, she said, like, you can spit on freedom because you've never had freedom. Yeah, and that's exactly it. Like, Americans and Canadians, and, you know, I don't know about the rest of the Europe and the Western world, but definitely here in North America, we're spoiled rotten. We've been born and raised and always had freedom. We never had to fight for it. So people do have that sort of attitude of like, oh no, the exotic brown people are, you know, with their exotic head wrappings and their and their yoga and their chai or whatever. Like, they just it's Orientalism, right? But they're okay to be proud of other cultures and to honor other cultures, but they're not okay to be proud of their own, which is, you should be proud of your own. This is the best country on the planet right here. Like, people should be saying that loud and proud and should not be apologetic about that. Yes, we have liberal values, and yes, we fought hard to get these liberal values, and we're not gonna let anybody come in here and try to change that.
Yeah.
You know, we fought to get Christianity out of secular public schools. We're not going to let Islam come in. Well, I mean, they do, unfortunately. Yeah. That's what's happening in Canada.
I mean, they're doing more and more.
They're doing more and more. But it's, you need to, like, I feel like liberals need to be unapologetically liberal. Like, have values and be strong about those values. Like, be just as vigilant with fighting Islam as you would be fighting Christianity. Like, if Christianity was trying to come into our governments or into our schools, people would be up in arms. But when it's Islam, it's like, oh, that's okay. you know, yeah. you have to honor them. It's just their way or
and
whatever.
And it gets back to that soft bigotry of low
Absolutely.
Expectations. That's
Absolutely.
Bigotry. That's
it is totally bigotry. And it's also arrogance because look at the rest of the world. Don't you think Egypt felt that way? Like, don't you think that Indonesia felt that way? Don't you think that, you know, the Maldives felt that way, which is like almost 100% Muslim now? Yeah. Like, all of these other countries, Iraq, Iran, like, they all had cultures before Islam came. And, you know, like in Afghanistan, when they were, Al-Qaeda bombed all of those huge Buddhas because they just mm-hmm. need to get rid of the culture that was here before Islam. Islam's the only thing that matters. ISIS bombing the statues in Syria, mm-hmm. same thing. They're all following the footsteps of their prophet, right? This is what he said to do. Make it Muslims look like a monolith. And the fact that now, 1,400 years later, people do think that Muslims are all one group.
Yeah.
But they would never think that about like Catholics or anything else, any other religion, right? But, and that's a testament, I guess, to, you know, how well he's done this. But that should scare people. Like, mm-hmm. that should make people aware that this isn't just, you know, right-wing hysteria. This is facts, like Ayan said. Like, look at the facts. Look at how these countries were living before, and look at how they're living now after Islam. And more recently, take a look at the UK, or take a look at Sweden. You just recently had I don't know how recent it was, but I just recently watched it, where you had an interview with the Kurdish guy from...
Tino Sanandaji.
That's right, yeah. So this is a phenomenon that's happening right now. Like, we can watch it happen, we can see it happening. When you've got the Muslims in Canada pushing for their kids to have Islamic prayers in public schools, when you've got them pushing for Islamophobia, you know, motion, these are things that should make people really worried. But instead, people who fight against it are being called bigots and racists and Nazis.
Right.
Like, Ayan Hirsi-Ali is a white supremacist.
Yeah,
now.
She's
Did
a white
hear?
Supremacist. Incredible. So this is really, in a way, you've just given me the best sell job on liberalism, which is what I'm trying to sell, obviously. Or not mm-hmm. trying to sell it, but mm-hmm. I'm trying to, these mm-hmm. are the ideas that I care about.
Mm-hmm.
But the best argument for it is that if we don't do those things, mm-hmm. then there's only two choices left, which is either all of our countries will become Islamized.
Mm-hmm.
That's one option, and we see mm-hmm. this happening across Western Europe. Or some really far-right authoritarian people are going to step in.
That's the other option.
And deal with it. But unfortunately, we don't have many political allies in this space, liberals that are willing to. Is there any? I mean, the only public person really is Sam and Bill, really.
Yeah, yeah.
In mainstream public people.
Yeah. Well, over here we don't, yeah. I mean, there are some people in France and other parts of Europe, because they're dealing with much more than we're dealing with. Like, I was mentioning the gender segregated areas already. So but it always has to reach that point before
right. and
people finally wake up.
Yeah, and it's I think that's what people like us are trying to stop. So when you see someone like Marie Le Pen, mm-hmm. without getting into like too much of the nitty gritty of the mm-hmm. politics, I sense at some level you have to sympathize with a piece of what she's trying to do, right? Like.
Mm-hmm.
I probably pinned you into a weird corner there with that one. But you know what I mean? Like, because you're talking about culture and all mm-hmm. of those things.
Mm-hmm.
She's addressing a lot of the issues mm-hmm. That you're talking about. So mm-hmm. is there some
So there are even the liberal politicians in France are not like our liberals.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they're much more aware. I mean, Marine Le Pen is like far right. So you don't even have to, like, here in America, it took a Trump to say what needed to be said, because our left were saying things like 99.9% of Muslims are fantastic, wonderful people, you know?
Yeah.
So you have the two extremes. But I think that you don't have to go that extreme when you're in France, because the problem is right in front of them.
Mm-hmm.
They can see it. So it's what people like you and I are trying to do is say, like, why does it have to reach that point? Like, why do we have to be Sweden first before we say, hang on a minute, maybe I was wrong with my assessment
right,
of
but
the
it's almost,
situation.
It's, right, but it's almost like the West is just so dulled into our freedoms that it's, in a weird way.
Yeah.
So would you argue that Trump was actually
arrogance.
Necessary in a bizarre way then? Because wouldn't this be worse? That's what I've tried to frame ultimately, is that the forces that we're fighting against here would have only been strengthened by Hillary.
100%.
So in a weird way.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean... as much as I love Obama, yeah, he supported the Muslim Brotherhood, like, with billions of dollars. He supported, like, Dalia Mujahid was his advisor, who's Muslim Brotherhood, like, and Hillary would have come in and done the same thing, yeah. So Ali Rizvi has a really good analogy, actually, for this, where he talked about if the house was on fire and there's one door and Trump's opening the door and you don't trust Trump and he's kind of shady and you don't know where that door is going to lead to, but the house is on fire and he's the only one that is opening a door.
Yeah.
So I think that's what led a lot of liberal people like Asra Nomani to vote Republican this time, because mm-hmm. even though she doesn't align with conservative values, he was the only one holding the door open. Mm-hmm. He's the only one that is recognizing the same problem that she is afraid of. And obviously millions of other Americans too.
Yeah. Well, there's so much more we could talk about. I didn't have to look down once, which is always a nice sign. But we're going to do a live stream right now with mm-hmm. Faisal's coming in, and we're going to do a little live stream. We'll do a little Q&A. Okay. I hope you'll come back, because
Oh my gosh,
feel like we could do this for 4 hours or something. Yeah. And you have an ally in me. I think you know that already.
Thank you.
And for more on Yasmine, check out her website. It is confessionsofanexmuslim.com.